call from my representative, Mr. Lenz, that Dino De Laurentiis is offering me to develop a screenplay and make a movie called Ragtime. For me, what emotionally attracted me so much to the book, besides the quality of literature, because Doctor who writes like an angel, is the scene when this bigoted fireman put a piece of shit on the seat of Colehouse Walker's car, and now this man has to make a decision, either to swallow his pride and clean it with his own hands, or try to get justice. And I lived too many years in the communist society where swallowing your pride was your, everyday food. So that was for me emotionally very strong to do this film and concentrate on the story of Colehouse Walker.
There was this burgeoning belief in ourselves that came around that time, that developed. And the film expresses that. I think we tried to express that Americana, if you will, our patriotism.
Of course, I wanted to, to collaborate with Doctorow on the screenplay, but Doctorow had a totally different idea. He wanted to include everything, which to do like 5 or 10 1-hour long segments of kind of a miniseries, I don't know, for television or for movies, the theaters, I don't remember. That's when Michael Weller came in and we started work. I never have a complete vision of the film before I see concrete places where I am going to shoot and who are the actors, Then starts the very important collaboration with Michael Hausman to go and find, prepare and show me, all kind of locations from which I can choose and, which will finally fit into the final mosaic of the whole film.
The key to any movie of this size is preparation. If you prep it correctly, your producing job changes. The biggest challenge was the two cities. Logistically, it was interesting to finish one section in New York and then to go to London and finish the other section. That was a big challenge. Also, the big scenes were hard to coordinate.
You are always very nervous when, I can be in total control of a small set and a couple of people, but when you have hundreds or thousands of people, you never know what will happen. And of course, then you rely very much on the quality of your first assistant director and his assistants, And but Michael Hausman was wonderful on several of the films I directed. He was the first assistant director.
Miloš understood the movie he wanted to make, and I wanted to be a first assistant director, producer that would be a director's producer.
When finally we, had a script which I was happy with and Dino was happy with, so now the cast. And Dino was wonderful because, he let me cast whoever I want, except he insisted that we must have one name, one big name, because he needs to pre-sell the film in Europe and things like that. So first I called, Jack Nicholson, whom I knew that, he is a nobleman enough to do a cameo. So I told him, there is a cameo in this film, Harry K. Thaw, man who kills, shoots architect Stanford White, and Jack got excited. Oh, yeah, and I can kill an architect, I'll do it, Miloš, So, but few weeks before the shooting, the Sandy Bressler, the representative of Jack, called us that Jack can't do the movie. So now, the only name disappeared from the film. So, in that time, I was thinking, my God, I met James Cagney socially before, a few months before. This was 1981 or 80, and the last film James made was 1960, 20 years ago, in Berlin. He was doing 1, 2, 3. Billy Wilder was the director. After the last day of shooting of that film, James said goodbye to filmmaking and left, retired. And many times Hollywood tried to lure him back, he wouldn't. And he told me that I should visit him sometime. He lived upstate New York. And I thought, man, that would be a name. So I called and I say, James, if you want to be in the movie, you can pick any part you want. You want to play Evelyn Nesbit, you'll play Evelyn Nesbit, you know. And he laughed and he said, okay, all right, okay, but I have two conditions. Yeah, first, I will never sign a contract. And secondly, I want to have a right to change my mind and not do the film until 3 days before my first shooting day. Okay, fine. I told producer that he wouldn't sign a contract. I had to tell him that, you know. But I didn't dare to tell producer that he can say no 3 days before the shooting.
And contact some colored big shots to talk for us in case we need to negotiate.
Very good, sir. Anything else?
Yeah. He said something about a car and a fire chief.
Conklin. Willie Conklin.
Get him in. I want to meet him.
Sir, that number doesn't answer. What do you want me to do?
Give me some coffee and a roll.
Yes, sir.
That he is in London now. Now, I am very nervous because I knew that he is having second thoughts if he can do it physically, mentally, if he's ready to do it and like that. And so I told him like 4 days before his first shooting day, I told him, James, why we are rehearsing the Pinkerton scenes, you know, why don't you come and watch the rehearsal? All right. So we have like 150 British extras and actors in the studio. The moment James came in the studio, in the room, they started to applaud. They started to applaud and couldn't stop applauding him. And James, tears coming down his cheeks, and he turned to me and said, well, I think I'll do the film.
Are you ready, Mr. Conklin?
Ready? Ready for what? What do you mean?
You know that someone's been asking for you, don't you?
What is this? It's a joke, huh? It's a joke, right?
No joke, Willie. The library over there is worth millions.
So?
And people keep telling me you're a worthless piece of slime.
Hold him! Can't talk to me like that!
Shut up, Willie! You're going to help us now. You're going to talk to that troublemaker, and I mean talk hard like you never talked before.
He was incredible because then when we were shooting, for example, I am shooting in his direction, of course, he's there. And he was, you know, with the age, everything deteriorates except talent. It was so brilliant. You know, he was sitting there looking like he was going to die every moment. And then I say action, and then there he is, and sparkle in the eye, and perfectly right on, you know. Then you say cut, and then you see a man like that. But I told him, you know, James, and I knew he's in pain constantly, he was, you know, sciatica and things like that. I'm telling him, okay, now I turn the camera on the other actor so you can go in the trailer and I will do your lines to your fellow actor. And he looks at me and says, no, it's better for him if I'll do it. It's better for him if I'll do it. That's a professional attitude, you know. That man was just absolutely amazing.
I had hoped you'd reveal to me along the way why you put such a rage in my heart. Tell me what to do now.
Howard Rollins, you know, it was very interesting. I was considering few in that time known, you know, black actors. And one day this young lady called me that she is now an agent and she wants to bring to my attention a new actor, great black actor. I said, sure, fine. I did more or less as a favor for a friend, you know. Here comes Howard Rollins, great looking guy. We read, he is brilliant. And that was it.
Howard was very serious. He was the most serious actor I worked with, you know, I can remember I ever worked with. He was a school teacher before, right before he did this. And he was just very concerned about the world, and he was very concerned about what was going to happen with jobs, and he was just politically very concerned. He was great.
I'm trying to do well in the firm. I try so hard, and sometimes everything seems to be going fine, and then I don't know. I don't know what's wrong with me. It just all falls apart.
Brad Dourif is an actor whom I admire very much and like very much, and I saw him first time when I was casting One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. He has this kind of genuine intensity in himself, which is so, captivating and mesmerizing for me.
Officer, I still want my car cleaned.
Oh, for Christ's sakes. Ain't you got any sense in your head? I'm trying to help you.
Jeff Daniels, I don't know if he was brought by the casting director, if I saw him something. He was the only real choice because it's a small part, but very important part, because that I didn't want the stereotype, the policeman is that bad guy who, beats up on the minorities and represents the power. No, that the guy, he has a brain and he has a good heart and he wants the things to be, dealt with dignity, but he can't help when the things don't go the way, he could sustain. So it was, in my opinion, difficult, small part, and he was perfect.
All of us for one person, for Evelyn. That's all we care about.
This little piggy went to market. This little piggy went home. This little piggy had roast beef. And this little piggy went wee, 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 all the way to the bank.
Liz McGovern, I thought she gave a wonderful performance. I think she is a very, very talented lady.
She was amazingly confident for a kid with that small amount of experience and really had some pretty clear ideas about what she wanted to do with the part. There are just some people that have a kind of grace and intelligence and class. That was pretty much Mary. I mean, there was just nothing. Mary couldn't do anything and not have it be ladylike. Oh, Mandy is a character and a half. Mandy was just an enormous amount of fun. He used to surprise me at how well he nailed this character. We were a gang of, actors, like, practically every other set. We all got along and we all sat and talked for hours. It was great.
It's not only who's close to the camera, but it's who is in the camera. Film is amazing, as you know. Film sees everything. We wanted interesting, good faces. And Miloš relied on me a lot to help him round out the cast with background. And we had hundreds and hundreds of background people to make them look real, make their faces look, pick people with interesting faces, and to costume them right.
It's very important that the three main collaborators are somehow, when it comes to taste and intelligence, in sync. And that's cinematographer, and that's set designer, and costume designer. Because if these three elements serve the same kind of a taste and the same kind of a philosophy of picture, then you are well off. You are very well off. And Patricia was very much instrumental in giving the film the look.
It was immense. It was immense. But don't forget, we were not alone. We were part of a vast organization. There was an entire team in England. There was a huge team in New York. And we had really the best of everyone. Dr. Rao's work, all of his books, depend on a truth of place, a sense of place. And we were very fortunate in New York to have enormous resources available to us. All of the sections of the story, the different worlds of the characters, almost had their own museum. The Schomburg Collection for Coalhouse Walker, Lincoln Center Museum of the Broadway Theater for Evelyn Nesbitt. There was a tremendous wealth of research. You find the streets of New York in New York on East 11th Street between Avenues A and B. That was our block.
When you're in a street, that's blocked off, then you're really actually in the world. So you really feel like you're in a place that doesn't exist anymore. and you're wearing the costume, and everybody else is wearing the costume, and it's really cool.
Because the village and the central village had not yet been in high-rise development, which of course it is now, but we were able to actually get full vista, looking east and west, and uptown and downtown. So though, although the street itself has a claustrophobic feel, the east and west vistas open out. What we're looking at is real. No mats, no mats. I don't think it could be done today.
What can I do for you? I design fireworks, that's my job. I can make bombs.
Well, I don't think the film would be made today because it would be too expensive and the subject matter is not politically correct today because it's basically about terrorism. And terrorism is not, in case of Coalhouse Walker, condemned as it should be, you know, today, under the events of the world.
For me, the experience was of shooting the film and being and actually walking around in that world was really the real ultimate thrill.
We felt we were expanding our vision. We were doing something grand and beautiful.
I'm a big believer in the process, and the process was great, and it was just like yesterday seeing it again, and I loved it, and it was a film that Miloš and I were proud of, and I'm still in touch with a lot of people who helped make that movie. We didn't make it alone.
I must say, stupidly, I love all my films, which is not judgment at all, because the director is the only person who can't see his own films as a movie. For one simple reason, because every moment I know what's coming next. And moment of discovery and surprises are so important for the, you know, perception of a movie. I'm happy with the film, yeah.